create a new GUI component. So far, our coffee machine GUI project consists of two dialogs, or commonly known as screens. The selection dialog allows the user to specify the desired coffee strength and to start the brewing process. The brewing dialog in turn displays the progress of the running brewing process. Now let's assume we would like to extend the application by a third dialog, a welcome screen, which should appear just in the moment when the coffee machine is switched on. In our case, it's when the GUI application starts. To implement such a welcome screen, you will need to add to the project a new class derived from the Mosaic class core group. You remember, the class core group implements a functionality common to all GUI components. Deriving a new class from it would result in a new GUI component. For your convenience, the gallery provides various ready-to-use templates that you can simply drag and drop to the composer, which adds a new class to your unit. In the navigation bar, click on the tab corresponding to the unit application. Now you switch to this composer page. In the gallery window on the left of the composer, click on the item Component Templates. This shows the content of the identically named gallery folder. Within the folder Component Templates, click on the item Component and drag and drop it to the composer. To rename the just added member, press the key F2 on your keyboard. Thereupon, you will see a small in-place edit field in the inspector window. Enter the new name Welcome Dialog and confirm the operation by pressing Enter. Now double-click on the brick Welcome Dialog to see its contents. A new composer page is opened and shows the new GUI component with an empty canvas area. The checkerboard pattern in the canvas represents the actual screen background. With it, you can easily distinguish during the design how transparent or semi-transparent the areas of the component will in fact be, composed with other screen contents lying behind them. Just below the canvas area, you see a few bricks and one annotation. These members come with the template you have dragged and dropped from the gallery window. However, in our simple welcome screen component, they are not necessary, so we just can delete them. To do so, click on the brick Update View State and press the key Delete on your keyboard to delete it. Do the same with the brick Update Layout. Then click on the big annotation member containing the text To Do and delete it as well. But be careful, please do not delete the brick Bounce. Our welcome dialog should occupy the entire display, which in our example has a resolution of 480 by 272 pixels. Since the visible portion of the component is determined by the size of its canvas area, you have to adjust the size of the canvas. For this purpose, click on the right edge of the thick blue border enclosing the canvas area and drag it until the canvas has assumed the width of 480. During the resize operation, the actual size is displayed in the status bar at the bottom of the Embedded Wizard Studio. Now, repeat the operation and drag the bottom edge of the canvas border until the canvas has assumed the height of 272. Hold down the key Shift during the drag operation to resize the canvas area exactly without the fixed grid. In an alternative approach, you can change the size of the canvas by modifying the corresponding property Bounce. As its name indicates, this property determines the size of the component and the position where to show it. Even if you have performed the previous steps and adjusted the canvas area as indicated, please follow the next steps to learn this alternative approach as well. In the upper area of the inspector window, look for the member This. It represents the actual edited component. Select this member. Now in the middle area of the inspector window, look for the property Bounds and modify it to the value 00480272 and confirm the modification by pressing Enter. Make sure you didn't forget to type in the angle brackets. They are part of the expression. That's it so far. With this approach, you are able to determine the correct size of the canvas area pixel precise and without having to drag on its edges with the mouse. After you have adjusted the canvas area, you see the brick Bounds overlaying it now. Since bricks are non-visual, this is not a problem. The brick will not appear on the screen. However, it is ideal to arrange the brick so you have a free entire canvas area. For this purpose, select the brick Bounds in the composer and drag it just below the bottom edge of the canvas area, so it should now cover the canvas area. Now we can focus on the interior decoration of our welcome dialog component. Let's say it should display a background image and some welcome text containing the version number of the coffee machine GUI. As you remember from the preceding analysis of the selection dialog component, such image and text contents are displayed by so-called views. Let's add an image view. In the gallery window, click on the item views. This reveals the contents of the identically named gallery folder. Within this folder, click on the item image and drag and drop it to the canvas area. Move the just added view to the top left corner of the canvas area. For this purpose, just click on the view and drag it with the mouse. To resize the view to fill the entire canvas area, click on the bottom right corner of the view and drag it. You can hold down the key Shift during this operation to disable the grid mode. The actual size of the view is displayed in the status bar at the bottom of the Embedded Wizard Studio. Also for this, there is an alternative approach to arrange and resize the view without having to drag it with the mouse. The view's property bounds determines its actual size and position pixel precise. Now even if you have performed the previous steps and arranged the image view as indicated, please still follow the next steps to learn this alternative approach as well. As long as the image view is still selected, look in the middle area of the inspector window for the view's property bounds. Modify this property to the value 00482272 and confirm the modification by pressing Enter. Make sure you didn't forget to type in the angle brackets. These are part of the expression. Until now, the image view displays a default image, but we want it to display the big image with the espresso cup you saw at the beginning of this article. As you remember, Embedded Wizard manages all images as bitmap resources. That means that all you have to do is to assign the correct resource to the image view. While the image view is still selected, look for the view's property bitmap. On the right on it, click on the small arrow icon to open the associated assisted window. Now enter the text cup. This text serves as a filter for the entries shown in the assistant window. Finally, double-click on the item Application Background Cup to select it as a new resource for the image view. Just at the moment you have modified the property bitmap, the canvas area is updated and you see the image view displaying the espresso cup. The background of our welcome dialog is finished so far. As mentioned previously, our welcome screen should also display some text. So let's add a new text view to the component. In the gallery window, make sure that the folder view is still opened. Within the folder views, click on the item text and drag and drop it to the canvas area. Arrange the just added text view to occupy the right half of the canvas area. Change the property string of the text view to the expression welcome to \n coffee machine 1.0. Make sure to type in the double quote signs and to add the line break by using \n. Just after modifying the property, the canvas area is updated and you can see the new text. So far, our welcome dialog already shows the correct text. What you want to change next is the font used here. The text appears with a small Arial font, which is the font used per default by text views. But we want the text to be shown with a 32 pixel large Roboto font. As you remember, the Embedded Wizard manages all fonts as font resources and our project already contains some of these members. However, the Roboto font with 32 pixel size is not yet part of the project. This means you have to edit such font to the project. Navigate again to the unit application. This is important because the font resource, like any other global entities and resources, may exist within a unit only. You can't add the font resource to a class. Next, in the gallery window, switch to the folder resources. Within the gallery folder, click on the item font resource and drag and drop it with the mouse to the composer. In the middle area of the inspector, look for the attribute font name of the just added font resource. Change the value of this attribute to Roboto. You can use the assistant window for this purpose. Here you can see the attributes of the new font resource after the modification. Now take a look at the attribute height. It is already initialized with the value 32, which is exactly what we want, so you don't need to modify it. So now the font resource represents a 32 pixel large Roboto font. Now let's switch back to the composer for the class Welcome Dialog. Make sure the text view is still selected. Look at the view's property font and open the assistant window associated with this property and enter the text APP to filter the display entries. In the assistant window, select the item Application Font. The expression application font explicitly addresses the new font resource added during the preceding steps. Accordingly, after assigning the new font to the text view, the canvas area is updated and the text is displayed with a 32-pixel large Roboto font, exactly as configured in the associated font resource. Press the key F5 on your keyboard to start the prototyper. Now the prototyper window opens, showing our just designed welcome dialog. As you can see, there is nothing spectacular about what happens in the prototyper. In fact, the component has no particular functionality. It limits to display an image and a text. Well, this is a bit boring, so why not add an animation effect to flash text? This can be achieved easily by using the provided animation effects, for example, the pulse color effect. So close the prototyper window again. In the gallery window, switch to the folder effects and drag and drop the item pulse color into the composer. As long as a just added color effect member is still selected, look in the middle area of the inspector for its property outlet. Open the assistant window associated with this property and enter the string text to filter the displayed entries. Select the entry text.color and confirm by pressing enter. With the previous assignment, you have established a connection between the color effect member and the property color of the text view member text. This means the color effect member is now able to access and modify the property color of this view. Now let's change the effect's property enable to the value 2. With this, the effect will be configured to start automatically. Finally, press F5 on your keyboard to start the prototype again. You see the text fading in repeatedly with a period of 1 second. The text is flashing. From a technical point of view, this animation is controlled by the just added color effect member. At runtime, the effect interpolates a value between two predetermined key values and assigns the result of this operation to the foreign property referred via its own property outlet. Here, it's a property color of the text view. We can say the color effect remotely controls the property of the text view. You can now close the prototyper and look in the inspector window for the properties value 1 and value 2 of the color effect object. These properties determine the key values the effect interpolates between them. The property value 1 determines the value valid at the beginning of the animation, while the property value 2 determines the value at its end. Actually, the property value 1 is initialized with the expression #00000000, meaning a transparent color. The property value 2 in turn describes a fully opaque white color with the expression #FFFFFFFF. Both expressions are color literals written in Cora syntax. These always consist of 8 hexadecimal digits in the fixed order red, green, blue and alpha. According to those parameters, the animation effect will interpolate between a transparent and a fully opaque white color. Since flashing a white text is less exciting, let's modify the property value 2 so that the text will flash with, for example, orange color. For this purpose, click on the property value 2 and open its assistant window. Select an orange color. To confirm the selection, click on the button with the check mark at the bottom of the assistant window. Press the key F5 on your keyboard to start the prototyper. As you can see, after changing the effect's end key value, the text flashes with an orange color. The results are almost what we expected. The only thing we do not like so much is the extreme transition to the start value at the moment the animation restarts. It does not look very fancy, so let's improve this. First, close the prototyper window. Now change the property symmetric of the effect object to true. Now start the prototyper again by pressing F5 on your keyboard. The welcome dialog is working now as expected. The text is flashing with an orange color and after we have modified the property symmetric, the animation effect runs forth and back between the key values instead of skipping at the end of the animation. Before we continue with the next step, close the prototype window again.